welcome you to the service this morning. Our message will be out of the book of James. Our Sunday school lesson will be out of the book of James, chapter 3. And so I'll give you a verse that I'd like for us to ponder as we prepare for our Sunday school time. The Bible talks about the tongue, and so we'll get into some things this morning. But the Bible says, even so, in verse 5, this is James chapter 3, verse 5, even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire can do. So that's going to give you a little taste of an appetite or taste for the Sunday school lesson this morning. As we join our hearts together, let's blend our voices as well. I'll have Isaiah come and open us with song, and then we will go forth from there.
Go ahead and turn your hymn book to page 459, and we will sing the first and second verse of Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. And when you find it, if you could please stand.
Family. We have the Vaughn family as well. We have America, of course, our country, leadership, both federal and local. We also have the Warren family, Ladner family, English family, Brown family as well. Anyone else you need to add to that list?
I remember the English dad. He said he's been spending a lot of the weekend time with him. Yes. And pray for those that got saved yesterday. Yes. And those we were able to make contact with. Looking for a church home. And we got to meet a lot of people, talk with a lot of people. So just pray that God continues to give the increase. Amen.
Of our community, of course, those who just come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I know it was a little rowdy in heaven yesterday.
Oh yeah.
Two souls came to Christ.
Amen.
that's something I don't know if we will ever come to understand until we get to heaven and we see the crowd that's there and imagine everyone cheering for that. That's a wonderful thing. Anyone else with any other requests? Okay. So at this point, we will go to the Lord in word of prayer and thank Him for these requests, but also to ask for His word to be done on the
Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for this time that you've allowed us to set aside and to come apart from the happenings, the busyness of the week. And Lord, as we meet together, we open our hearts, we open our arms of fellowship. Lord, we ask that you would help us, Lord, to give pause and to lift these burden requests up to you so that you can do what you need to do through them and for them your time. Lord, we ask that you would help the lad and the brother, Lord. We ask that you would give them continued comfort through the days that they've had recently. And Lord, we ask that you continue to bless the Warren family as well. And Lord, many heartaches from many families, Lord. We think of the Brown family, Lord, of Donald and his family. We ask that you continue to give help and strength and guidance to them. Lord, we ask that you would help the English family, Lord, Brother English's father. Lord, you know the exact need that is there. You know the strength of it. You know everything there is to know about what he is going through. And Lord, we ask you to just put your arms of comfort and blessing around him. And Lord, may the family do the same as they support him in these days and these difficult times. Lord, we ask you to help the Vaughn family. Lord, with the expectation of a new one being brought into their family. And Lord, again, the continued gift of life is such a precious blessing. Lord, we ask that you would have that child be raised in the nurture and admonition of your principles. Lord, we ask you to help Andrew Keith, Lord, the leadership and the guidance that he needs. Lord, you know where he is, you know how he is, and you know what to do in these matters. Lord, we ask you to give him the focus he needs, Lord, to turn things back to you. And Lord, we ask you to help us, Lord, as we think of Mrs. Wallace, Lord, your family as they gather around and support her in these days of weakness for her. Lord, give the family, Lord, your angel, as we know, our granddaughter, give her comfort, give her encouragement, Lord, give her the strength that she needs to support her, Lord, in these times that they are very difficult and tender, Lord. Pray you help that relationship, Lord, to be special as she nears her days. And Lord, I pray you would help the Torrance family, Lord, the needs that are there in that family. Lord, I pray you would continue to help Sister Ishii as she has contact with them, Lord, and that she be encouragement, a witness, a testimony that she needs to be. And Lord, we ask you to help us, Lord, as we think of our church family, Lord, those who haven't been to Grace, but have had contact with us, Lord, I pray you would help them, Lord, as they seek a home, a church home, that you would give them, Lord, the ability to discern the truth and discern what is your word and what is, thus saith the world, per se. But Lord, we ask you to give them direction, Lord. If it's not Grace Bible Baptist Church, Lord, you would give them the right home. Lord, we ask that you would help them be able to cultivate a relationship with you. And Lord, thank you so much for the two souls that have come to you yesterday. And Lord, we ask that you would help their hearts, Lord, to be filled, help their hearts to be blessed, help their hearts to be encouraged. And Lord, in the days to come, Lord, help them to get to know you on the intimate level so that they can see the goodness of you. Lord, I pray that you would help us as a church, Lord, to impact this community and the surrounding areas, Lord. There's so much to be done for you. Your kingdom, Lord, is needing expansion, Lord. We ask that you would help us, Lord, to each one reach one so that we could be a positive impact on Alabama and Mobile and these area parts, Lord. Help us, Lord, as we open our word today, we ask that you would help us, Lord, to be focused on what you say. Help us be focused on what we need to change so that we can leave here more like you. And we ask these things in your name we pray. Amen. So this morning, as I said before, we're in James chapter 3. So we'll go ahead and jump right in. James chapter 3. And I asked myself, should I even read a verse before I start. I don't want to scare anybody off. When we start talking about the tongue and we start talking about what people say and how we say it, we get a little defensive at some points. But the truth is, there's much to say about the tongue. There's much to say about how we address others and how we need to be aware of how the Lord needs to be represented. Believe it or not, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are an ambassador. You are an ambassador. What is an ambassador? pastor to do. He doesn't just go to and from and get all kinds of accolades or get all kinds of recognition. He is recognized by what he represents. A testimony is a powerful thing to protect. And I don't want to make a spoiler alert, but we can't protect that testimony the way we need to, because we are imperfect people. Doesn't mean we should not strive to do so, but an area that we seem to overlook quite a bit is what we say and the impact of our words. So if I had to title this message or this Sunday school lesson, it would be man's deadliest weapon. I'm not talking about nuclear. I'm not talking about missiles and rapid gunfire. I'm not talking about bombs. But many times the words can have the same effect as what those items have. The tongue is something that God has placed in front of us to, at least this text. God has placed this text in front of us so that we know how to use this powerful weapon. It's powerful for the good. It can be powerful for the negative. But we need to be aware of how to use it. So let's look at James chapter 3. We're going to read a series of verses. James chapter 3, we'll start in verse 1, and we'll go down to verse 10. The Bible says, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold, the ships, which though they be so great, and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listed. Even so, the tongue is a little member, and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that defileth the whole body, and it setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea, is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God." In verse 10, "Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not be so." So you can see God is, this is somewhat peeling back the cover of how God addresses the tongue. This is just a snippet of what God has to say about the tongue throughout the Bible. And there's other things that come into play that condition us for the use of the tongue. But this morning I want us to look at how we should tame the tongue. How we should recognize that this is man's deadliest weapon, and how we ought to reverence the gift that God has given to us. Let's have a quick word of prayer and ask God's blessing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. And Lord, we ask that you would help us as we look at your word concerning the tongue, Lord. I pray that you would even control my tongue as I speak today. I pray that you would help us, Lord, to recognize the power of this gift that you've given to us, and Lord, the responsibility that we have to use it. In any prayer, amen. So the world has a slight understanding of the tongue. But God, the creator of the tongue, the one who has placed the tongue in our mouth, tells us everything we need to know about this powerful tool, this weapon, as we lay it out here. So the Bible says in the book of James, it's a whirlwind of iniquity. There's a lot going on with it. Now, we need to understand also, as I call the book of James kind of the Proverbs of the New Testament, James is the book of action. So the action that we have is going to be something that is based off of the faith that we carry with us. So what does this really have to do with it? Well, I mean, there's an action to everything. And if we stop and consider what we have to do to get the words out of our mouth, I don't want to get scientific, I don't want to get technical with it, but there's a chain reaction. And it's based on our faith. So I'll say it this way. What you believe is going to determine what you say. How you believe is going to determine how you say it. Now, faith without works is dead. The Bible says in James 2:20, just from reading the verse, it says, "But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead?" So understanding that we don't just happen to say something, it slipped out. It's a result of something that's deeper. There's a root to what we say. And if we're owning it, we will be careful what we say. Many times we have to take a step back and say, how do I really want to say this? Now, if we're honest, that doesn't happen all the time, does it? It doesn't happen. We don't harness the power of the tongue like we should. How many of you have taken a moment this week and someone asks you a simple question, and you say, hold on one second, let me think about that. And you hear the tick-tock, tick-tock, tick-tock. Very rare, if that, may have happened once or twice, but very rare does it happen. Sometimes we reserve our speech we pull back what we're going to say. We think heavy on what we're going to say if it pertains to life, if it's a critical moment, or if it's something that requires a deep, long look ahead. I tell you that if we took the thought of how is this going to impact me 5 minutes from now, we probably wouldn't say a lot of things we say.
And if we're thinking like we think in this flesh,
you say, Brother Ed, it'll take too long for me to say what I have to say. It'll take too long for me to process what I have in my heart when something happens. By the time I finish thinking about it, the moment's gone and everything's passed, and it won't even have the same impact that I want to have when I see it. That could be by design. Now let's get kind of plain with it. Suppose somebody flies in front of you in traffic, and we take a few moments. Let me think about what I'm about to say. Most of us would get up and say, yeah, that's not even, I'm just wasting time. Because we know that person's going to be down the road before they have a chance to hear what I wanted to tell them. But the fact is, you probably should have held that. Someone walks up to us and cuts us off in line. We think about how long the place is. By the time we process this thought, they're checked out in line. They're sitting in their car, they're about to drive off. Good is that? It's for your good, believe it or not. Many times we could remember that testimony I was talking about being so hard to protect. I would shudder to think how many times we may be in a line and we cut off by somebody. We say something to somebody only to find out our paths are going to cross 5 minutes from now. And it could be in a matter of, I need their help. Oh, that's that guy. Hold on. Whatever happens to him happens. We probably have dismissed maybe our help that we need. I don't want to pontificate too much on that, just think on too, you know, dwell on that too long, but you see where I'm going with this. Staying calm, staying paused, or putting that pause button in front of us in our conversations many times could be a help. Many times it could be a testimony saver. Well, let's look on. Now, our faith has the power to influence the tongue. So as we believe, Lord, you brought me here for a purpose. Lord, you've allowed me to cross paths with this person for a purpose. I am here for such a time as this. So I need to think about what I'm going to say. Now, having the Christian life, many call it the exciting life. You know what generates excitement?
You don't know.
You never know what's going to happen. But you know, that's a good thing. You never know the blessing that God has for you. So it's up to us. God gives us this tool, the tongue, to channel its use in the right direction. It can generate excitement because, Lord, I don't know what's going to happen. And I know pastors experience this, but Lord, I don't know who you have for me, but show me the one that I'm supposed to lead to the Lord today. And as we go forward and we say, I don't even know what that person looks like, wouldn't it be just a kind of a safe thing to behave the same way to everybody? To have that same cordial greeting to everybody, because you don't know which one is the one. And by God's power, all of them could be the one. So our faith, if we believe, God, this is the person that you would have me to speak to today. This is the person you would have me to witness to today. This is the place you have me in today for a reason. This is the job that you have me on. This is the person that you have me working with today. Guess what? Our faith is going to generate, it's going to demonstrate through our words. Therefore, those words are action. But it's going to help us to understand. It's going to help us to see how we can use those words positively to impact someone's life. Let's look a little further. Not only is our words action, not only should faith influence the tongue, but let's look at verses 1 through 5. And God's word is just, it's just powerful the way it is, but we'll stop and have a couple of comments here. But starting in verse 1, my brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. Now, what this is saying simply is, understand that you are, as the Bible calls it, a master, a teacher. Understand that you're teaching someone through your words. If I could ask you, what is the most, I'll just ask you one. Who do you think is paying attention to you most of the time as a parent? Children. And when they say things that are out of order, what do we look? Oh, I can't believe they said that. What we're really saying is, I can't believe they repeated what they heard me say. Don't tell everybody what we talk about. They have that innocent way. Things happen, but they don't just happen, remember? How I believe, do I believe it's wrong to say this thing? Well, I don't really believe it's that wrong. That's not that bad of a word, but when the child says it, oh my. Where did they learn that from? Don't ask that question. We know. Be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. So we have taught something to our child, inadvertently, seemingly, but as we know, as we speak, they are like sponges absorbing everything. We are teaching them, but what's going to happen? The consequence of it, we shall receive the greater condemnation. We should. Where did they learn that? Whose child is that? Where did they come from? Let's follow. Let's watch what car they go to. Let's watch what couple they go back to when they finish Sunday school, when they go back to their parents. Anyway, I'll move on. I don't want to get anybody in trouble. Verse 2, for in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man. You understand what this is saying? If you tell me, well, I never offend anyone. I never slip up in my speech. The same is a perfect man. So you're saying you're perfect. Maybe we should have reverted back to the practice that we were talking about. Thinking for a second. I'm not going to say I'm perfect, but that's what you want to say, right? But how the Bible says this, it catches us right in the act. For many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. So God describes this as, if you say you can control your speech, then that must mean you can control everything else, too. Wow. That's a powerful statement. I wish I could say that. I wish, but this is the Bible talking. So I'm not telling you that you're imperfect. The Bible is saying that. Let's move on to verse 3. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths, that they may obey us, and we turn about the whole body. I'm not a cowboy. You probably know that by now. I'm not a country guy. I'm not someone who has ridden horses for their whole life, but I've ridden a horse, real experience. I'd say I must be intermediate because I've rode a horse maybe 3 times in my life. Bottom line is, don't follow me on a horse trail. But I remember getting on a horse. There is something that is incredibly powerful. Well, it's a horse. That's a lot of animal. But when you're sitting on a horse, you can feel the power. Even if you're just sitting on it, you can feel him breathing. And this is a beast. Now, you set that beast free, or you give that beast the illusion that he has no boundaries, I hope you got something to hold on to. It's not a smooth ride unless you're experienced. But I remember getting on a horse, and I say, what do you do to make them go? And they tell you to make a clicking noise and kick them a little bit. Kick them. And then when we get that little bit of feedback, as I like to call it, you kick the horse and the horse, and he moves, it scares you a bit. Because you realize, what? This is a lot of beast. This is a lot of power. How do you stop them? Stop. Whoa. Don't go there. That doesn't work. I'm letting you know from experience. Okay. That's the extent of my horse riding. But the Bible, as the Bible illustrates, we put bits in the horse's mouth so that we can control it. Now, I didn't know what a bit was until I saw it. I thought it was a bit of this or a bit of that, a bacon bit or a sugar bit. I know they like sugar cubes. It's nothing like that. It's a little metal piece that goes in her mouth. And it cuts a little bit. If you've ever gotten, I'm telling myself real bad today. Have you ever had a bag of chips that was so good, you tried to put a whole chip in your mouth, and then it cut the corner of your mouth? You didn't know it until the end of the bag, right? Because the chips were so good, you ignored the pain. The taste was overwhelming. But then later on, you get some water, and your mouth gets a little dry, and the corners of your mouth start to ache a little bit. And they start to sting. Now, I don't know how a horse feels, but you can control me with a potato chip like that. It hurts bad. But for a horse, this little bit is a controller. And all you do is pull him a little bit with the reins. You pull him a little bit to the right, and he does one of these numbers, and he knows to go to the right. So he knows that I don't want any more pain in that direction, so, okay, I'm gonna get over to you, and I'm going to yield and go that way. Same thing for the left. You just pull back a little bit, and he pulls him. And then if you pull him back totally, he pulls his head back and our whole body is controlled. You see what's happening here? The Bible is saying if we listen to God, if we're controlled by the Spirit, if we're allowing the Spirit to be the bit, and sometimes it does hurt because the Spirit just reminds us of the truth. We're faced with the truth. The truth is not pretty many times. It's not comfortable many times. But sometimes the Holy Spirit says, whoa. And it causes us to bridle our tongue and sit back and pause. But it controls such a strong element. It controls such a strong beast. We need to be mindful of the control that we need to have. And I love how the Bible just so vividly describes this as putting a bit in the horse's mouth. It goes on further. In verse 4, behold also ships, which though they be so great, are driven of fierce winds, yet they are turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listed. So you have this huge ship. I've never been on a cruise, but I trust that you understand this. That ship's got to have a way of turning around. And it takes a while to turn the ship around. But it's done so with a small rudder. Small in comparison to the rest of the ship. And you take one of these cruise ships and the rudder could be, several tens, yards long or whatever you want to call it. But it's a magnificent rudder. But it's small compared to the rest of the ship. What am I saying? This little tongue, this little member has the ability to change so much and turn so much around. But if we don't use it properly for the devastation, boy, the terrible confusion it could be. Think about small phrases that control life situations. What about the words "I do"? They control a lot. Truth be known, they try to control a lot. Now, I'm not saying the other person that said "I do," but what I am saying is how I treat my marriage, how I believe my marriage is going to determine what I say in my marriage. If I believe that my wife is my gift, my helpmeet, my one and only, guess what? My words are going to govern, or they're going to be governed. They're going to control what my interaction is. Many times we miss the boat. I didn't say miss the turn. We miss the boat because that little rudder of "I do" is out of whack. What about the word "guilty"? If you're in court and you're on the wrong side of the law and you hear the words "guilty," guess what that does? That changes the course of your life. That changes what things are to come. It can take away things. It can add to things. So the power in the words can depend on the situation. But the Bible says, nevertheless, it needs to be controlled. We need to be controlled or controlling our words. Power of words can control the course of nations. Think about it. As we heard in the illustration before, a leader can say things. A political leader can say things. "I promise I will do this." And guess what? It starts to change the course of the nation, how they vote. It starts to change the reaction of people. Well, so-and-so said that they would do, or they said it. I don't know if they thought about what they were saying. And then we learn later on down the road they may have not followed through. And then we have another confusion that's a result. "Well, he said he was going to do it, he never did it." What about when a powerful leader issues a threat? It drives fear, doesn't it? It drives chaos. And then the ripple effect, other people out there, their belief starts to manifest itself in words. They start to say things hurtful against one another, one side versus the other, and one country against another, one person against another, one family member against another, mother against daughter, son against father. All these things start to happen. All because of the little member that was not controlled. Words. Words. The tongue is a fire. The Bible says in verse 5, "Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth." Now, fires can have been started with sparks. All the great fires on the West Coast, when they talk about hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles being destroyed by all these wildfires, it started with one person. Whether it was an intent of click with a little spark or a match that ignited a small bush. It was a little fire at one time, but the devastation after that is powerful. And it spreads. That's how we get the phrase. It spreads like wildfire. Now, back in our day, I was talking to my wife about something. I'm not going to get on that tangent, but back in our day, it was a little different. Why? You say one thing to the next person in the neighborhood, and it took a little bit, but it got around the neighborhood pretty quick. Now, all you have to do is, I don't want to set anybody's phone off. I was going to say that person's name. There's several names you can say now. Say, hey, blank, type this message, blah, blah, blah. You say this message, and then, blank, and guess what? It's around the world in another sentence. Behold how great a little fire can be. It's been said before, but once you put it out in cyberspace, you can't get it back. Once you say something, you cannot get it back. Just like a tube of toothpaste. You squeeze it out, it's not going to go back in the same way. You could probably get in there, it's going to take a while to get it back. So it is regarding the testimony. You say the wrong thing, you say something offensive, you can't pull it back. Oh, I'm sorry, please forgive me, I didn't mean that. You said what you said. If you didn't mean it, you know, you would, if you didn't believe that, you would have never said that. I think that's, you just told me what you really thought. We can't get it back. So we have to be careful with the tongue. We have to be careful. It has to be tamed. Let's look at verses 6 through 8. The Bible says, when the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity, so is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. This little tongue can destroy the body of Christ. One person says something to another, and it spreads that wildfire to the next part of the church. Next thing you know, the church is split, divided, things are going down the road, and I don't know what got into that person. I thought a Christian said this. I thought I was supposed to be encouraging them. The lives are destroyed. You have to understand the power of our words. The power of our words. Now, I don't want you to think that this is all negative. We'll get to some of the positive a little bit later. But as the Bible says in verse 7, for every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind. Now, take some thought for this. And maybe it's not. Maybe you might think I'm crazy. But the Bible says here, every kind of beast, birds, serpents, the things of the sea, they're tamed. Now I thought to myself, is that because they don't have a tongue? No, they got a tongue. They got a tongue. Why do you think that is? Because they speak the same language. Now I don't know, as far as a dog barking, bark, bark, that's the same language. Woof, bark, that says the same thing. I don't understand it. But God didn't pattern their speech. God didn't pattern their communication after his. God doesn't have a Bible for them. There's something unique about us. We're created in the image of God. So we must be the ones that have the responsibility. If it's a snake to a snake, they hiss together and they go the same way. They got their thing sewed up. Locust, one, chirp, 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 chirp. Whatever they do, they make that noise, and then psh, a whole slew of them. Looks like a big old dust cloud, but they're all moving together. You get ants, you throw a piece of, I did this yesterday, matter of fact, you drop a little piece of a donut, and 2 or 3 minutes later, you can almost envision the ants going, hey, look what I got over here. And you see a long trail. All in the same mind, all in the same purpose, all in the same communication. They are stopping it up for the win. But what about us? God says, let me give a blessing to Pastor. Oh, Pastor shouldn't have got one of those.
You don't deserve one of those. Why did you get one of those? I don't understand it. Man, I was supposed to be blessed like that. Well, I don't know. Isaiah might have one of those. What about Isaiah? What, he got a blessing? I didn't get mine. I don't know about this Christian thing.
Why is it that we have to monitor our tongues? Because it's wild. It's a world of iniquity. Our faith is not in check, so we start to manifest it and speaking these things. Bible talks about who can know the heart is desperately wicked. But we all know what's in the heart comes out. It's dangerous. It's dangerous. Verse 8. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. I saw this video where a guy was trying to milk a snake. If you've never seen anything like this, and they get the venom so they can have the anti-venom and do other scientific things. But the guy knew how to handle the snake. He picked him up and he had him by the head, and he got to the tip of the little serum or the little jar that he milks him in, and the snake bit down. But his fang went a little too far and hit the side of his finger. And he put him onto the thing, and he got a little bit of venom out. He said, I got bit. And he put the snake back down. What am I saying? It's like us. Sometimes we think we're controlling the snake. And we think we got a control of it. We think we can handle it. And one small word goes sideways. And the person in the corner says, I didn't do anything, but you said this to me, and it just hurt. I've never been hurt like that before. All the while, we're saying to ourselves, I didn't think I could hurt anybody. I didn't think about that person. I didn't control my speech. That's a small illustration, but I want you to understand, this is serious. This is serious. If we're serious about serving God, we need to be serious about the way we speak, the way we carry the speech, the way we allow the tongue to be used, the way that venom is controlled. The Bible is serious when it talks about the tongue can no man tame. And it's full of deadly poison. Even gives us an illustration, verse 9 and 10. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. God is my Savior. I don't know about that guy who created over there. I don't know. He's a little, you understand. That's God's creation. And we don't take that serious. That's the part that gets uncomfortable, because why? It includes all of us. It's an unruly evil. Let's not mock God's image. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not be so. But they are. Bottom line is, whether we know it or not, whether we feel like we have gotten a license permit to carry around a weapon, we don't carry around swords. We got something more powerful than that. We got this tongue. God has given it to us so that we can carry it right. We need to check it every day. Lord, help me to be a blessing to someone. Help me understand what they're saying so that I can speak words of encouragement to them. Help me understand how to get to know this person. Lord, help me understand this person's need so I can help them spiritually. Many times we even find ourselves asking, Lord, I don't even know how to pray for this person. That's why we have an intercessor called the Holy Spirit. The intercessor goes to God and says, Father, he's doing the best he can, but this is what he's trying to say. He discerns the intent of the heart. But I want you to be encouraged. We have the ability to use the tongue correctly. I mean, look around at the blessings you have. Look around at the families that you care for. Look around at your loved ones. You have issued the right words. of love, encouragement, and have and maintain a good testimony. But you know, it takes work to do that. It takes work. Do we really want to work for God? There's a lot of work to be done. Boy, sometimes I wish I was a good communicator. I really want to say something, but we gotta learn to talk each other's language. We gotta learn to talk and communicate with impact, with meaning. How do we do that? We ask God, Heavenly Father. He's the one that's created all of us. If we're right with God, remember, if we have our faith in check, if we are believing right, then we're going to say things that are right. We're going to pause when we need to. We're going to move forward when we need to. But it's all a matter of checking that tool, checking that weapon with God. Heavenly Father, this morning, I pray you help us all. Help us as we carry around this powerful weapon of the tongue. Help us to know how to use it. Help us to trust you and its use. Or most importantly, help us to give it over to you. And Lord, we ask these things in your name we pray.